Yes, am I visible now? It'll be good if some of you can turn on your videos. You know, it'll have a sort of feeling of, taking classes. Yeah, I can see Adesh. Fine. Extremely sorry for the delay. There was some confusion regarding the meeting, so I'm really sorry for the delay. Anyways, just to get to get just I want to have an idea about what is the composition of this class? Like, how many of you are going to write UPSC in the next year, in 2022? And how, yeah, I can see Rekha. And how many of you are going to write mains this time, January 2022? How many of you are going to write mains this time? No, fine. So I guess all of you are going to write your examination in 2022, right? And oh, someone, there is someone who is going to appear for this examination in 2023. All right, you are here to get some idea about political science and international relations as an optional subject. Is that correct? Is that correct? Yes, all of you must have political science as an optional subject. Is that correct? Yes. Fine. Fine. Basically, what I'm going to do is that, I'm going to discuss. And is the all of you have decided that your optional subject is going to be PSIR, or is there anyone who has some confusion regarding, say, PSIR and sociology and some other optional subject? Is there anyone who has some confusion regarding the two choice of optional subject? Is there anyone? No. Okay, perfect. So all of you have now decided that PSIR will be your optional subject. And now basically you want to know how to increase your score in political science as an optional subject, and how we should go about this particular optional subject, including what are the sources to be followed, what are the books to be read, right? This is what you want to know from this session. Yes, correct. Fine. Now, first of all, let me tell you the importance of PSIR or any other optional subject for that matter for the entire scheme of optional subject, for the entire scheme of UPSC. Now, if you look at the scheme of UPSC, UPSC has three stages, right? It's mains, and the third one is personality test, which is also called as interview, right? And the preliminary examination is basically qualifying in nature, wherein the marks scored by the candidate in the prelims, they are not counted in your overall marks, but the marks of mains and personality tests, they are calculated in your final merit list, right? Now, if you look at mains is of subjective in nature, right? Whereas prelims exam is objective in nature. Now, mains has four papers, GS1, 2, 3, 4. There are four papers of general studies. One paper is of essay, right? 250 marks. And then 500 marks for optional subject, be it PSIR, be it any optional subject, right? So if you look at the structure of mains, the mains is heavily leaned towards those students who can express themselves well through writing, right? So those students who have excellent writing skills, or whoever who can express themselves in a very good words, they can score good marks in mains, right? Because 1,750 marks are allotted for mains, right? Now, in mains, how much knowledgeable you are, it is less important as compared to your ability to write answers in an effective manner. Always remember this, right? For example, how much knowledge of political science you have, how much knowledgeable you are, whether you have done PhD in political science or not, it doesn't matter much. What matters more in mains is your ability to write good answers. Your ability to express what you know effectively through words. And believe me, I have seen students who are extremely knowledgeable, but they are, when it comes to writing or putting down their thoughts, they face difficulty. You must have seen this kind of students as well. You know, if you ask them to speak on a particular subject, they will speak at length for 4 hours, 5 hours, XYZ amount of time. But if you ask them to write the same thoughts in a systematic and a scientific manner, they face problem. Right. Now, mains, I told you that. Now, mains, your writing skills are very, very important. So always remember, right? So mains is more of a skills as compared to your knowledge. So you can clear UPSC mains with limited knowledge if you have excellent presentation skills. Presentation skills as in writing answers, right? Now, this was the first thing I wanted to tell you. Now, the second important thing towards which I would like to focus your attention or bring your attention is that, you know, if you look at the structure of general studies papers or the questions of general studies, and if you look at the syllabus as well as the questions of optional subject, any optional subject for that matter, then over a period of time you will realize it has been seen that, and it has been proven that scoring marks in general studies, it is difficult as compared to scoring marks in optional subject, right? And there are various reasons behind this, right? So now what I am trying to do is that I'll tell you what is the importance of political science as an optional subject for you to clear your mains and hence your examination, and how optional subject is more important as compared to your general studies. Right. This is the first thing I'm going to explain you scientifically. And second thing, I'm going to tell you some tips about answer writing, how you should write answers, what are the mistakes which you should avoid. And third thing is that, you know, I'm going to tell you about the course, political science and international relations as an optional subject, which will be taught by me, how we are going to go about this particular course. And I will also discuss some of these sources. Right, source material, what are the books, what are the important books from which you should read, so on and so forth, right? So what I'll do, I'll share the PPT, right? But I guess because of the technical problem, once I share my PPT, you will not be able to see me, right? So please excuse me for that, right? But I'll share the PPT and I'll explain the points systematically, right? Is that fine? Is that okay with all of you? And in between, if you have any question, you can stop me at any time. You can turn on your audio and you can ask questions straight away. Or what you can do is that you can write down your questions on a notebook, and then at the end of the session, you can ask those questions. All right, fair enough, fine, okay. So let me share the PPT. Acha, before I share the PPT, I forgot to introduce myself. You know, since the session was already delayed, well, my name is Dinesh Ahir Rao, and I am currently working as an assistant professor of political science in University of Delhi. I've been teaching political science from last more than 5 years. I've done my master's and MPhil in political science from Jawaharlal Nehru University. Basically, I am not a political scientist as when it comes to degree. My basic education was in engineering. I have done my BTEC, but later on I shifted towards political science. Right. So this is the brief introduction. I usually teach Indian polity for general studies and political science optional subject. Right. So this is my brief background. Now let's straight away move towards the next part of our session. Yes. Can you see this PPT? Can you see this? Any one of you can turn on your audio and let me know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. But are you able to see me?
No.
Okay, fine. Anyway, sorry for this technical thing, right? So first question is, why answer writing? So I'll discuss answer writing skills first, and then I'll come to political science option subject, right? So the first thing is, why answer writing matters in UPSC? It's very important. You will ask this question that, is it sufficient to have knowledge, right? There is a philosophy that if you have knowledge, then you can write good answers. It's not necessarily correct, right? So now, in the beginning, I told you that, how much knowledge you have is less important than how you present what you know effectively, right? Because the structure of examination is such that 1,750 marks are allotted to answer writing, right? Your UPSC, your selection in UPSC is not on the basis of your personality. It is not on the basis of your knowledge or your degrees. It is on the basis of how well you can write answers. Why? Why I'm saying that? Yes, having good personality is a bonus. Because if you look at the marks, allocation of marks, personality test has only 275 marks in the entire scheme of UPSC. And when it comes to the answer writings, it has been allotted 1,750 marks. So even if you have an average personality, you still can, even if your communication skill is not that good, even if your English is weak, still you can clear this examination. Why? Because the UPSC mains examination is heavily leaned towards your ability to express yourself effectively through answers. Right? As Thomas Jefferson once said, the most valuable of all talent is that never using two words when one will do. Now, what happens is that I have seen that students who have knowledge, for example, take the example of Plato or take example of Aristotle as a thinker. Now, if someone who has done PhD or say master's or MPhil in political science, then he will have a lot of knowledge on political science, on Plato and Aristotle, right? Now, what happens is that more often than not, I have seen that those who know everything about every political philosopher or those who have a lot of knowledge, and those who focus only on reading and those who ignore answer writing, what I have seen is that students who are very knowledgeable and those who ignore answer writing, they face problems in mains, right? Because, since they know each and everything, they don't know what to write and what not to write. This is the biggest problem that the people face, right? So yes, you should have knowledge, you should have understanding of a particular thinker or a particular topic. Your concept should be clear. Yes, all these things are important, but along with that, it is also important to write what you know effectively. And you should be able to express what you know by using few words. For example, Aristotle's theory of citizenship. I can write about or I can explain Aristotle's theory of citizenship by using 20 pages. Or I can also explain Aristotle's theory of citizenship by using only 22 pages or one page. Now, this is called as ability to express yourself by using few words. And this is what UPSC is looking for. In the entire mains, UPSC wants to check whether you can express yourself, number one, effectively, and number second, by using lesser words. But because, as a civil servant, you don't have that much of time to give knowledge to each and every person who visits your office, or in a meeting, you can't go on speaking at length on a particular topic. You should be very specific. You should not beat around bush. So this is what an IAS officer should not someone who should beat around the bushes, right? He should be someone who should hit the bull's eye. He should speak only only relevant things, and those things which are of a very important significance. And he should not discuss each and every aspect of every scheme or every program or every element of whatever is being discussed, right? So, as I've told you in the beginning, if you look at UPSC, the structure of examination, the total marks, the UPSC is of total 2025 marks. Now, out of 2025 marks, 1,750 marks are allotted for mains, right? Now, if you calculate the percentage, right, the total 86% of marks are allotted for mains. And mains is subjective in nature. Subjective in nature in the sense you have to write answers. It is not objective. Mains is not objective like preliminary examination, right? Now, when it comes to subjective examination, in subjective examination, it is very important to know how to write good answers. So if you look at the structure of examination, you realize that it is very difficult to clear UPSC without good answer writing skills. Right? Now, why I am telling you this? Now, compare UPSC with other exams. For example, look at SSB. SSB is basically not Service Selection Board, but the SSB, which is conducted to, select officers for Indian Army, Navy, and Air Force, right? Now, even in SSB, the purpose is to select officers, right? But officers for armed forces. Now, if you look at the scheme of the selection process, it is not based on how well you write your answers. No, not at all. It is based on your personality, completely based on your personality and your psychology. Right. So it means that you can become an officer of armed forces through your personality. If your personality is good, if you are physically strong, if you are psychologically very strong, and if you have basic officers like qualities, then you'll be able to become an officer in an Indian Army or Indian Air Force. Right. So it is not necessary to have a good answer writing skills to become an army officer, for example. Right. Similarly, if you look at the scheme of SSB, Service Selection Board, wherein they conduct examination for, say, income tax officer or certain other grade B post, again, SSC CGL, if you look at the scheme of examination, the exams, they are of objective in nature. And ultimately, the last stage is personality test interview, right? So even in the exams like SSC CGL, your answer writing skills are not that important. You can clear SSC CGL by having good command over the subject and having good factual as well as conceptual knowledge, right? But this is not the same with UPSC. See, to appear for any examination, you should understand the examination. Without understanding the nature and scheme and structure of examination, you cannot clear that examination. You cannot start the preparation of that examination, right? Now, based on our discussion, now you will realize that UPSC is one examination where your answer writing is very, very extremely important. It is very important. You cannot ignore answer writing, right? So even if you have knowledge and if you have not practiced answer writing, if you don't know how to write answers, it is very difficult for you to clear your UPSC. Yes, is this point clear? Is this clear? Now, why I am discussing this is that, the beginners, they focus more on reading books than practicing the answers. Or they feel, even I was the beginner, even I when I started preparing for civil services, it was in 2008, I used to feel that if I know about Plato, if I know about Aristotle, then I'll be directly able to write good answers in the examination hall. But I was wrong. Later on, I realized that, that is the biggest mistake any candidate can make is to take answer writing for granted. Yes, content is very important. Content is very important. You should have sufficient content on a particular topic. Then only you will be able to write answers, right? So you should have a sufficient knowledge of a particular topic, right? But along with that, it is not sufficient to have only a sufficient knowledge of a particular topic. Along with that, you should also have the skill or talent of putting that that knowledge effectively through words, right? And that is why answer writing is very, very important, right? And this is the first thing which I always tell to all the aspirants of UPSC, because more often than not, all the students who fail to clear UPSC mains is not because they do not have knowledge. It's not because they took mains for granted, but it is because they ignore the answer writing skills or the answer writing practice. Okay, because you know, in UPSC, all of us know what are the sources to read, from where to read, and most of the students, they join the similar coaching institutes. The subject material is, the coaching material is same throughout the books. The certain reference books are same. For example, for Indian quality, every average or sincere UPSC aspirant is going to read Lakshmikant. That is for sure, right? So every sincere candidate reads the similar kind of sources. And the person who clears preliminary examination, he has sufficient knowledge. That is why he has cleared the prelims, right? In the first place, right? But still, why it happens that majority of the people, they are not able to clear mains? Out of 10 to 12,000 students, only 3 or 3,500 students, they are able to clear mains. And why others, they fail? The reason is this, because they ignore answer writing. They only focus on covering the syllabus, preparing the content, having the sufficient content, having the knowledge of a particular topic, and they ignore the answer writing. And that is why the candidates, they could not clear, or they do not clear the mains. If you look at the speeches of every topper, you will realize that all of them, they focused on answer writing skills. All of them, they always say that please practice answers, write answers, right? So this is what is the importance of answer writing. Now let's move forward and discuss about the importance of optional subject, right? Because you know, I'm going to talk more about optional subject. I'm not going to talk about general studies, right? So now, why optional subject is more important for mains as compared to other elements of mains examination? Now again, you have to understand the structure of examination. Now I've told you that if you look at the structure of mains, there are four general studies papers of 250 marks each. Just a second. Yes, can you see? Can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if you look at the scheme of examination, general studies, they have four papers. So 250 marks each, right? 250 marks each. So it comes to 1000. And I'm sure you know about the scheme of optional subject, right? So optional subject, it has two papers, paper one, and sorry for my handwriting, I'm writing it fast and using digital pen. So paper one is for 250 marks, paper two is for 250 marks. So total optional subject carries the weightage of 500 marks. Right. So at the outset, you will feel that for general studies, you have 1000 marks. And for optional, you have only 500 marks. So if mathematically speaking, general studies has more weightage, it has more double weightage as compared to your optional subject. Yes, mathematically speaking. However, let us compare general studies and optional subject. Yes, first thing is correct that optional general studies have been allotted. The marks allocation for general studies is more. It is double as compared to optional subject. Fair enough. Fine. Now, let us look at the opportunity where we can score more. Right. Let us compare general studies with optional subject. Now, first is syllabus. Now, if you look at the syllabus of general studies, then you know the syllabus of general studies is very vague. You know, it is open ended. You know, it is not specific. Right. For example, in history, the UPSC has only mentioned that you know Indian national Indian culture, Indian art and culture. Now, Indian art and culture, it is a very abstract term. Now, each and every element of art form will be included in the syllabus or a topic of Indian art and culture. Everything will be included in the culture, right? Everything under the sun will become a part of your general study syllabus, right? So, and same goes with the other topics, you know. For example, UPSC has mentioned internal security as a part of general studies paper 3. Now, internal security itself is a very, very broad area, right? Now, internal security includes a hell lot of things. For example, it includes Naxalism, it includes cyber attacks, it includes, smuggling, it includes black money. You know, each and everything will become a threat to internal security. Everything will become a criminal rights will become a threat to internal security. The smuggling across the border will become the part of internal security, right? So the syllabus of general studies is open-ended. It is vague. It is abstract. It is not specific. And that is why whenever the syllabus is abstract and vague and open-ended, your scope of preparation, your study material becomes very huge. It becomes very vast, right? Then second thing, now since the general studies syllabus is very abstract, and the general studies syllabus is as compared to optional subject, it is very vast as well. Now since the general studies syllabus is abstract, it is not specific, and since it is since the syllabus of general studies is vast, it takes more time to prepare for general studies as compared to optional subject, right? Then the third thing is that if you look at the difficulty level of GS questions, GS 1, 2, 3, 4, and compare the difficulty level of questions with optional subject, then you will realize that the difficulty level of GS questions, it is higher as compared to difficulty level of the questions of optional subject. You know, the question paper of optional subject in UPSC mains, it is more or less predictable. But the general studies papers are not predictable. You know, it is very difficult. The difficulty level of general studies is higher as compared to optional subject. So if you compare general studies with optional subject from these three point of syllabus, preparation time and difficulty level, you will realize that you can score more in optional subject as compared to general studies. And over a period of time, since 2013, if you look at the marks of even toppers in general studies, their marks are average. For example, you realize that in general studies, cutting across papers, out of 250, candidates get an average of 100 to 110. Average and above average candidate, they get marks in this range of 100 to 110. Even if the topper, if you look at the marks of toppers, they are also in this range. At most, they can go to 115. But since 2013, there is no candidate, for example, who have secured 140 or 150 marks out of 250 in say GS1, GS2, GS3, GS4. Sometimes candidates they get 130 or 135 marks. But gone are those days. Now, even scoring good marks in general studies paper 4, it is nowadays, it's difficult, right? So if you look at the marks of general studies cutting across papers, they are average. If you are average and above average students, your marks will be in this range of 100 to 110, right? Why is it so? Because general, the difficulty level, the preparation time, the syllabus, all these factors, they contribute. And the checking is also very difficult. The evaluation of general studies is really, really difficult as compared to optional subject, right? So based on this discussion, you know, you will realize that, now I have told you about general studies. Now, if you look at the optional subject, then you will realize that out of 500, it is easy to get 300 to 350 marks in optional subject. You know, if you look at the marks of toppers, even those who have got 400 to 450 marks in general studies, they have secured 300 to 350 marks in optional out of 500, right? So, and if you look at the general studies, so out of 500 in optional, you can easily get 300 to 350 marks if you prepare well. If you practice answer writing, if you cover the syllabus, you know, you can easily score 300 plus marks in option subject out of 500. Now, if you look at the general studies, now, even if general studies has 1000 marks, I've told you that the average marks, even of toppers, they are in the range of 400 to 450. So out of 1000, even toppers, they get, out of 1000, even toppers, they manage to get 400 to 450 marks. That's it. Right? And I'm talking about four papers. Whereas in optional subject, out of 500, you can score 300 marks easily by devoting less amount of time as compared to general studies. Right? Now, this is the importance of optional subject. Right? Now, you'll realize that scoring marks in optional subject is easier as compared to scoring marks in general studies. Yes, right. And, you know, since UPSC is a competitive examination, you know, it is your success in the examination is based on the relative performance of the other candidates, right? And you know that the relative performance of the candidates in the general studies is average. So you'll realize that based on our discussion, now tell me where you can score more and get edge over the others. Where you have opportunity to score more than others. Is it general study? Is it in general studies or is it in optional subject? Yes? Tell me. Anybody?
Answer.
Yes? So where you can score more? Where it is easy to score more? Is it in general studies or is it in optional subjects?
Obviously, it's in optional subjects.
Yes. And why? I've told you about the syllabus, the preparation time, the difficulty level. And the fourth thing I forgot to tell you is that, you know, in general studies, all the questions are you know, compulsory. You don't have any choice in general studies. But if you look at the optional subject, you have choices. Out of eight questions, you have to appear, write only five questions, right? And the first and the fourth, first question and fifth question is compulsory. But apart from that, in optional subject, you get choice. So even if you skip a particular topic, or a particular a part of a syllabus, then also you can easily cover the entire paper. But the same is not in the case of general studies. You know, for example, in general studies paper two, general studies paper two has three parts. One is Indian polity and constitution, Indian constitution and polity. Second is governance, and third is international relations. Now, you cannot, in general studies paper two, you cannot do that. You cannot think, I will prepare only for internet. I will only prepare for Indian polity and governance, and I will skip international relations. No, because there are bound to be questions on international relations for sure. Right. So you cannot leave any part of syllabus in your general studies. You have to prepare something. Right. But same is not the case with optional subject. Right. If you have heard the All India Rank 1 this year, Sushil, I don't remember his name. He said that he did not cover all the syllabus, entire syllabus of anthropology, which was his option subject. Yet he got good marks or decent marks in anthropology, right? So always remember that in your UPSC mains, your optional subject is more important than your general studies. Even if general studies has more weightage, yet your optional subject is more important. And whosoever focuses more on optional subject, and whosoever has made effort in optional subject, they have managed to get good marks in optional subject, and hence they have managed to clear the mains, right? So whether you'll be clearing the mains with good numbers or not will depend on your performance in optional subject, right? And in general studies, you just have to be average. You don't have to be extraordinary. You will never see any candidate or any topper who is extraordinary in general studies. All the sincere candidates, they are average and above average in general studies. But you will find candidates who are excellent in optional subject. Right. So this is the importance of optional subject. That is why optional subject matters. Right. And as far as PSIR is concerned, PSIR matters a lot, Because even if optional PSIR has 500 marks, but it has overlap with general studies paper 1, paper 2, paper 3, paper 4 as well. And even in essay, there is section B of the essay paper, there are topics on the issues related to political science. For example, women empowerment, Panchayat Raj institutions, international relations, so on and so forth. So if your optional subject is political science and international relations, and your command over political science and international relations is good, then effectively you are preparing for 1,000 marks. Effectively, you are preparing for 1,000 marks. Because if you look at General Studies Paper 1, then there is an element of syllabus which overlaps with PSIR optional subject. For example, a post-independent happenings, right? After independent, integration of princely states, linguistic reorganization of states, so on and so forth. It is part of General Studies Paper, Indian society, so on and so forth. Impact of globalization on Indian society. These are all part of General Studies Paper 1. You also study in PSIR optional subject. Entire paper two, General Studies Paper 2, except governance, is a part of political science optional subject, right? So 90% of General Studies Paper 2 will be covered if you cover political science as an optional subject in an effective manner, in a systematic manner. You don't have to prepare for general studies apart from some 2-3 questions of governance, right? Then same is the case with general studies paper 3. There are certain elements, yes, general studies paper 3 is more of a science and technology and economics, economic happening, economic development. But even in general studies paper 3, you have internal security, you have certain elements which land reforms, green revolution, this part of General Studies Paper 3, they are also part of PSIR optional subject. And even in ethics, there are certain questions on philosophers like Gandhi, Ambedkar, Plato, Aristotle, Socrates, Machiavelli, so on and so forth, right? So what point I'm trying to tell you is that generally speaking, optional subject is more important as compared to general studies, because even if optional subject has less weightage, but it is more scoring. But if your optional subject is PSIR, then it is very important for you if you have good command over PSIR optional subject, you will get, you have opportunity to score, say, around 800 marks, 700 to 800 out of 1,000. And if you get 700 to 800 marks out of 1,000, you will be easily able to clear the examination, right? So this is the importance of political science as an optional subject and importance of answer writing. So far, so good. Yes. Is there any question? Abhi tak sabko samajh mein aa raha hai?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Now, the next important question is, how to write answers, right? How to ace answer writing? Many of you might have doubts over this. So I'm going to discuss 11 golden rules about answer writing quickly. Okay, and I'll be more happy to take your questions. So let me discuss the golden rules. So and there are 11 golden rules according to me. Now the rule number one and the most important rule is read the question very carefully, right? Now, what I have seen is that during the mains, what students do is that the moment they get the question paper, students straight away start writing the answers. They will only read the basic theme of the question and they will straight away write whatever they know about that particular theme. For example, if the question is on, say, office of governor, or say if the question is on decline of Indian parliament, then student will write on Indian parliament. Whatever they know about Indian parliament, they will write. Now, this is the biggest mistake which candidates do. And that mistake is they do not read question carefully. Understand that in mains, the evaluator or the examiner do not know you, or does not know you. He does not know whether you are your gold medalist or whether you have done education from an excellent university, so on and so forth, doesn't matter. He is going to judge you on the basis of your answers. Okay, and you know, the first thing the examiner is going to look is whether you have read the question carefully or not, and second, whether you have understood the demand of the question or not. This is the first thing which evaluators or which examiners they look into, right? So the first golden rule is to read the question very carefully, and only if you read the question carefully, you will be able to understand the basic demand of the question, right? So it is, and you know, it is only after you understand the question, and if you understand the demand of the question, then only you will be able to write what examiner wants you to write, right? See, what more often than not, students, they write what they know in the answers. They do not write the answers on the basis of demand of the question. Okay, and why it happens? Because candidates, students, they do not read questions carefully. So rule number one is read question very carefully. And for UPSC, it is all the more important. Why? Because the UPSC asks, in one question, UPSC asks multiple questions. So in UPSC, you will see that there are various parts and subparts of the questions, right? So if you don't read the question carefully, then your answer is not going to be complete. You will not be able to do justice with the demand of the question, right? So it is very important to read question very carefully, understand various elements of the questions, and understand the overall demand of the question. This is very, very important, okay? Because in answer writing, it is important to write what examiners want you to write based on the demand of the question, and it is less important to write what you know, right? For example, if the question is on decline of Indian parliament, you are not supposed to write about Indian parliament, that, you know, Indian parliament consists of two houses and president according to Article 79 of the Indian constitution, and you know it has, and the Lok Sabha has this many members, Rajya Sabha has this many members, so on, bicameral legislature. So this is not important, this is not required. The demand of the question is that you are supposed to write about the factors which are responsible for decline of the Indian parliament. And those factors can be decline in the numbers of sitting of the houses, then suspension of the question hour, frequent adjournments and pandemoniums in the house, then cash over cash for vote scandals. You know, then the misuse of anti-defection law, so on and so forth. There are so many factors which are responsible for ineffectiveness of the Indian parliament. And in this question, you're supposed to write the factors. You're not supposed to write about Indian parliament as such. But if you don't read the question, you will only, if the students, they only focus on the theme, then the theme is Indian parliament. Yes. The question is about Indian parliament. The question is not generally about Indian parliament. Question is very specific. The question is about decline of the Indian parliament, right? And if you don't read the question carefully, you will write only about general answer about Indian parliament, right? I just gave you a very simple example. There are various other examples as well. For example, let me give you a case study of one question which came in last year's mains. The question was about Representation of People Act 1951. And the question was that, you know, the procedure for disqualification of the members of parliament under the Representation of People Act 1951, it is very complex, it is very difficult, right? This was the statement, and you are supposed to write answer on that particular statement. So, you know, the question was very specific. The question was about procedure to disqualify sitting MP or MLA. The question was very specific. Even if the question was on Representation of People Act 1951, but the question was very specific regarding the procedure to this. So your answer should be only cater to this particular demand, that you are supposed to write about what is the procedure and why the procedure is complex, why the procedure is difficult, and you're supposed to write about this solution, possible solution to make the procedures, to simplify the procedure, right? This is what it was expected in the answer, but students, more often than not, most of the students, they could not write answer on this question because they did not understand the demand of the question. And why did they not understand the demand of the question? Because they did not read the question carefully. Right. So what happens is that, you know, yes, you know, in the heat of the examination, in the heat of the movement, in a hurry to complete the paper, we do not focus more on reading questions. Okay. So don't do this. Avoid this mistake. Okay. I hope rule number one is clear. Now, rule number two is related to rule number one. Okay. Now, rule number two, I already told you that, you know, UPSC usually ask questions within questions. Okay. So if you read the questions of UPSC, particularly optional subject as well as general studies, you know, you will find that there are various parts and subparts of the questions. Okay. Now, what I have seen is that what candidate do is that candidate, they devote disproportionate amount of time and space to cater to the first part of the question. Why? Because it is asked first. And when it comes to catering to the other parts of the question, they run out of time as well as space. Now, this is another mistake which students do. You know, so the second rule is that, you know, you have to do justice to all the parts and subparts of the questions. You have to give proportional importance to all the parts and subparts. You know, let me give an example. Suppose for PSIR optional subject, suppose there is a question which says that critically examine Marxist theory of state, right? Critically examine Marxist theory of state, okay? Now, do you think that there are multiple perspectives about nature of state in Marxism? Explain. Now, this question has two parts. In the first part, the examiner is asking about critical examination of Marxist theory of state. Right? There are two parts in this question. The second question involves, do you think that there are multiple perspectives on state within Marxism, meaning all the Marxists, they do not have similar views on the state. There are different, even within the Marxism, there are different perspectives when it comes to the state, right? So this question has two parts, right? So you're supposed to write about critical examination of Marxist theory, and you're supposed to write about multiple perspectives. Now, suppose this question is for 20 marks. Now, what happens is that both these parts are equally important, and there is enough content on both these parts. So what examiner they do, you know, they divide these 20 marks into 10 marks for first part and 10 marks for second part. Now, what happens is that candidates, they give more importance to the first part, critical examination of Marxist theory of state. Okay. So out of 250 words, they will write 170 to 180 words on only catering to the first part of the question. And when it comes to catering to the second part of the question, they only have, say, average 70 to 100 words or 90 words, right? Because the whole question is for 250. You have to write the answer within 250 words only. So here, candidate is giving disproportionate importance to part one. And when it comes to part two, he has only 70 to 90 words, which is not enough. Now, what happens when, now I've told you that examiner has allotted equal marks to this question, right? 10 marks each. So even if you write excellent answer, even if you cater to this first part of the question excellently, out of 10 marks, you will get 6 marks, not more than that. 6 to 7 marks. Not more than that. That is for sure. Now, the second part is also for 10 marks. Now, you have written only 70 to 90 words on that, which is not enough. So, out of 10, you will only get 3 marks. So, overall, you will manage to get only 11 to 12 marks. I am talking about optional. In optional, 11 to 12 out of 20 is less. In general studies, it is a very good score. But I am talking about optional subject. So you will get average marks in this question. Even if you know this answer of the second part, but what happened is that you have not given proportional importance to the second part. Why? Because you have devoted so much of space and time on catering to the first part. So by the time you deal with the second part, you run out of the space, or you run out of the verbs. Okay, and that affects you. Okay. So the second golden rule is you know, you should do justice with all the parts and subpart of the questions. You should give proportional importance to all the parts and subparts. Now, you should be intelligent enough. It is not as if all the parts and subparts, they have equal weightage. It might happen that for first part, the evaluator might give 60% weightage in the second, if there are three parts. The second part, he might give 40% weightage if there are two parts. If there are three parts, he may give 50% weightage for first part, 30% weightage for second part, and 20% weightage for third part. Now, it depends on the evaluator. Now, on the basis of question, you will get to know what will be the proportional importance. It requires practice. With the practice, you will realize, you will get to know what is the proportional importance of particular subpart, and then you will be able to deal with them proportionally. But the rule number two, remember that you have to deal with all the parts and subparts effectively. You know, you should not treat the first part with more importance, and you should not deal with second and third part with lesser importance. No, right? So this is rule number two. Now, rule number three is regarding content. It is regarding body, right? Answer should have intro, body, and conclusion. It should be divided into these three parts, right? So when it comes to body, you know, your body should be very impressive, you know, and you know, so that is why to make your body impressive, body of the answer impressive, you have to write multi-dimensional answer. So you have to cover multi-dimensional answer means an answer which covers all the aspects of a particular topic. Political, social, economic, cultural, psychological, ethical, so on and so forth, right? Now, the best thing to find out various dimensions of a question is to look into the syllabus of GS1, GS2, GS3, and GS4. Whenever there is a question, if you want to find out possible dimensions, now GS1 is about history. Right? More or less, it is about history. GS2 is about polity and IR. GS3 is about economy, environment, and science and tech. GS4 is about ethics. So what can be the possible dimension of any particular topic? One possible dimension will be historical dimension. Another possible dimension can be a political dimension. International dimension, economical dimension, environmental dimension, ecological dimension, science and dimension from science and technology perspective, and ethical dimension. Right. So this is how you can write multiple dimensions on a particular topic. It is there in the syllabus itself. Right. So whenever there is a question, you should cover multiple dimensions. Your answer should not be bi-dimensional or unidimensional. You should cover as many dimensions as possible, right? For example, about COVID-19 crisis, there might be historical dimension, there might be political dimension, you know, lockdown, right to privacy, restriction on liberty, so on and so forth, international or global dimension, you know, vaccine development, role of WHO, so on and so forth, right? Then economical dimension, the price of vaccine, you know, distribution of vaccine, environmental dimension, sustainability, sustainable development, so on and so forth. Science and technology, right? How you can use science and technology for in our vaccine development, then ethical and moral dimensions. You know, all these aspects you can write when it comes to a question on COVID crisis, right? So try to write multidimensional answers. You know, cover as many dimensions as possible. And now what happens is that students, they only write answer from Indian perspective. Be it general studies or be it optional subject. Students only write Indian perspective, nationalist perspective, the perspective from the point of view of India. Yes, I mean, majority of the answer should cater to the Indian perspective, but you should at least add 2 to 3 lines about the global dimension of a particular issue. Even if the question caters to, say, Indian, even if the question is asked in the Indian context. For example, if the question is on, say, Panchayat Raj institutions, is it a part of Indian government and politics? Paper 2. Now, Panchayat Raj, suppose there is a question on ineffectiveness of Panchayat Raj institutions or lack of devolution of 3Ds, or sorry, 3Fs, fund, finance, and functionaries. Now, in this question, you have to write the majority of the answer should be from Indian perspective. But you can write global perspective as well. For example, you can write about how in say, countries like Bolivia, there is democratic decentralization, or say Brazil, you know, they have empowered their panchayat, their local institutions. Then you can also give example of Germany, where Germany has also devolved majority of the powers to the panchayat raj institutions. And so you can write about the global role models when it comes to panchayat raj institutions. And if you write the global dimension, then you are definitely going to get an edge over the others. Why? Because you have not only limited yourself to the Indian perspective, or you have not limited your answer to the Indian perspective, but you have went beyond and you have also written about the global good practices. For example, let me give you another example. Suppose there is a question on Office of Speaker or partiality of the Office of the Speaker. Speaker is partial. Speaker is not performing his or her duties in an unbiased and partial manner. Okay, then you can write about critical analysis of the Office of the Speaker, anti-defection law, when it comes to deciding a particular bill as a money bill, Speaker takes the viewpoint of the ruling party, so on and so forth. Now, even if the question is on Indian Speaker, you can write about good practice in UK, wherein in UK there is a healthy development or healthy convention, wherein once the speaker, always the speaker, wherein, you know, whenever speaker decides to recontest the elections, then none of the political parties, they put candidate against the contesting speaker, so that speaker gets elected unopposed. Now, this practice is very important. Why? Because now speaker knows that he is going to be re-elected. He doesn't need his or her political party for that matter. And that is why the speaker is bound to be bound to play impartial and neutral role in the parliament. So this is the good practice which is developed in UK. So even if the question is on Indian speaker, you can write global dimension from the point of view of good practice of UK, right? So there are other examples as well, right? So the point I'm trying to tell you is that do not limit yourself to the Indian perspective. Indian perspective, yes, majority of your answers should cater to Indian perspective, but you should write at least some points about global dimensions, right? Fine. For example, if you write about Election Commission of India, you can write about any other election commissions which are performing very good, which are doing excellent job, right? So far, Indian Election Commission of India is very successful, and other countries are emulating the Election Commission of India. But if there are other bodies, similar bodies which are doing good, then you can give example of such, you can give such case studies, right? So write answers from global dimensions, global perspective as well. So this is about rule number 3. Now the rule number 4 is again regarding body, is beautify and enrich your answer. You know the way whenever there is a function, you know, you prepare yourself well, you get a haircut, you bleach your face, and you buy new clothes, and for ladies they wear ornaments, so on and so forth. And why do you do so? Why you do so? Why? Because you want to present yourself. You want to make yourself presentable in front of others whenever there is an event. For example, for interview, whenever any candidate appears for an interview, he usually wears a very neat and clean costume, and he takes care of all these things about presentation. So similarly, presenting your answer is very, very important, right? The way you beautify yourself, the way you present yourself in front of others, it is also important to beautify and present your answers in front of the examiner in an effective manner. This is very, very important. Okay. So you should focus on beautifying and enriching your answer. Now, how to do that? No, you can beautify and enrich your, and this is also called as value addition. You know, there is a famous term, value addition. You have to add value to your answer. And you can practice value addition, or you can add value to your answer through giving data, authentic data of any body, international body, government body. You can quote index data, for example, Human Development Index. You can quote, human HDI, India's rank in that. You can quote reports of various national and international bodies and commissions. For example, when it comes to question on governor, you can quote the recommendations of Sarkaria Commission, Punchi Commission. Okay. When it comes to Panchayat Raj institutions, you can quote the report of Manishankar Iyer committee reports. So you can quote the recommendations or suggestions given in various reports. You can quote research studies. You can also quote judgments of higher judiciary. For example, if the question is on Uniform Civil Code, Article 44 of the which is envisaged under the Article 44 of the Indian Constitution, is a part of directive principles of state policy, right? So in about writing answer on UCC, you can also quote about judgment of higher judiciary, that is Supreme Court and High Court, observations of Supreme Court and High Court, that how the Constituent Assembly which framed the Indian Constitution wanted Uniform Civil Code. And what is the rationality or what is the method, or what is the procedure or mechanism through which we can have Uniform Civil Code? So you can write the views of judges as well to beautify an enrich answer. You can write the reviews of the latest published book as well. You can write book review as well. This is book review is very important as far as optional subject PSIR is concerned. For example, if there is a question on Green Revolution, then you can write about the book written by Vandana Shiva on Green Revolution. The name of the book is Seeds of Suicide. So you can write about the views of Vandana Shiva, the latest contemporary books and the views expressed by the author in that book related to that topic. Right. So these are the ways to beautify your answer. Right. This is rule number four. Now, rule number five is regarding intro. Right now, what happens is that, more often than not, candidates write a very lengthy introduction. The introduction is very lengthy. The students, they write unnecessary historical background information about the particular topic, that is why they write very lengthy introduction. See, UPSC, I've told you that, you have to write answers in 250 to 300 words. That's enough. So on any given topic, you have to write answers in 250 to 270 words. If you cross word limit, then let's suppose 250 to 270 words. Now, if you write 100 words introduction, how you're going to cover all the aspects of your answer, right? So your introduction should be spot on. You should hit the nail on its head. This is called as hitting the nail on its head, or you should hit the bull's eye. Jo poocha hai usko directly address karo. Don't try to write historical and background information. Don't start from 1947 when India became independent. No, directly address the demand of the question. Your introduction should be very precise. It should be very, very short. It should be very, very precise, and it should be to the point. You know, as a bureaucrat, you should not beat around the bushes. You know, you should straight away come to the point. हम नहीं कहते कि यार ये फालतू का बकवास मत करो, जो पॉइंट पे आओ जल्दी पॉइंट पे आओ, है ना. हम बातें करते करते सब हमारे इसमें बहुत सारे दोस्त होते हैं जो फालतू की बातें बहुत करते हैं. सो नन ऑफ नो पर्सन लाइक्स टू लिसन टू सच पर्सन हु टॉक्स नॉनसेंस रादर देन टॉकिंग अबाउट द टॉपिक. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अगर आज का जो हमारा सेमिनार है ये है आंसर राइटिंग और पॉलिटिकल साइंस ऑप्शनल सब्जेक्ट को कैसे डील करें. अगर ये छोड़ के अगर मैं आपको बताता कि कैसे अपने आप को मोटिवेट रखना है और आपने किस तरह से ग्रेजुएशन में तैयारी शुरू करनी है, अगर मैं यहाँ से शुरुआत करता तो दैट वुड हैव बीन यूजलेस. व्हाई? बिकॉज़ नाउ आई एम बीटिंग अराउंड द बुशेस, राइट? नाउ नोबडी विल वुड लाइक टू बी लिसन टू सच काइंड ऑफ पीपल, राइट? सो सिमिलरली नोबडी वुड लाइक टू रीड द आंसर्स ऑफ एनी सच आंसर्स हुज इंट्रोडक्शन इज इररिलेवेंट or which is not spot on, right? Do not try iterations of the examiner. Examiner wants you to directly hit the nail on its head, right? Now, the introduction should be like a trailer of a movie. You know, you must have seen the trailer of the movie. In the trailer, not everything is revealed, but the basic theme of the movie is revealed, right? So the way trailer of the movies is made, you know, it is very intriguing. अगर मूवी का ट्रेलर अच्छा है तो ही लोग मूवी देखने जाएंगे. अगर मूवी का ट्रेलर ही खराब है तो लोग मूवी देखने नहीं जाएंगे. और अगर ट्रेलर, अगर सपोज 2 घंटे की मूवी है, अगर 1 घंटे का ट्रेलर अगर बना दिया किसी ने तो क्या लोग वो ट्रेलर को देखेंगे? कितने मिनट का ट्रेलर होता है? 5 मिनट, 7 मिनट, इतना ही होता है. 2 घंटे की अगर मूवी है तो क्यों? देयर इज अ रीजन बिहाइंड दैट. सो योर इंट्रोडक्शन, थिंक योर इंट्रोडक्शन एज ट्रेलर ऑफ योर आंसर. It cannot be too long, and trailer of a movie should be exciting. Your introduction should be exciting and must evince the interest of the examiner. कि आगे क्या आएगा, है ना? He should always सब कुछ पहले ही introduction में सब कुछ reveal नहीं करना होता है, है ना? Trailer में अगर सब बता देंगे कि last में murder किसने किया है तो nobody is going to watch the movie. अगर movie murder mystery में है तो, right? So introduction में सब कुछ reveal मत करो. It should be exciting. It should evince the interest of the examiner. Okay, so this is about introduction. This is very important. This is very, very important. I guess point number 5, rule number 5 is very, very important. This is regarding introduction, right? So do not write lengthy introduction. Now next is rule number 6. This is regarding conclusion, right? The first 4 rules were regarding general rules and regarding body. The 5th rule is regarding introduction. The 6th rule is regarding conclusion. Now, most of the students, they either do not write the conclusion or they ignore its importance. Okay? Rather than writing conclusion, students only summarize what they have already written. No, your conclusion should not be a summary of whatever you have written. And more often than not, I've seen that students, rather than writing the conclusion, they only repeat whatever they have written in the body or the introduction. Hence we have seen that how the farmer suicide is a big problem in India. The introduction is with farmer suicide is big social evil in India, and the conclusion has also ended with the same point. The repetition is happened. You will not get the marks on such conclusion, right? The conclusion should not be a summary, and conclusion should not be repetition of whatever you have written. The conclusion should be positive. It should be forward looking. It should be futuristic. You know, and in conclusion, you can give suggestions. You can give way forward, so on and so forth. Okay, and most of the students they ask me this question: "Sir, we know the importance of conclusion, but we don't know how to rewrite it, or write the conclusion." Now, you're not going to learn how to write conclusion in a day. The best way to know or understand how to write conclusion is to read conclusion of any editorial article. आज का हिंदू उठा के लीजिए, उसमें जिस तरह से conclusion लिखा रहता है ना, जिस तरह से वो article end किया होता है, कोई भी editorial article उठा के देखिए, उसमें जिस तरह से end किया है वो particular topic को, वो होता है तरीका conclusion सीखने का. So you can learn how to write conclusion by reading conclusion or ending of any editorial article in newspaper, in in journal, in magazine, so on and so forth, right? So this is regarding rule number six. Now the other rules are, I'm going to talk about presentation. This is very, very important. Presentation. Rule number seven. Now, you know, rule number seven is regarding presentation. You know, I've told you that presentation is very, very important. See, I've told you that how much knowledgeable you are, how many number of hours you have studied per day, you know, in which university you have studied, from which university you have studied, from which university, which institute you have done your coaching, whether you are gold medalist or not, you know, it doesn't matter. There is, you know, evaluator is not aware about yourself, your knowledge, your background, your educational background, whether you are gold medalist or average student, he does not know you, right? So evaluator is going to judge you only on the basis of the way you have presented your answer. And that is why rule number seven is understand the thinking of the evaluator. Understand the psychological mindset of the evaluator. Understand how evaluator thinks. You know, this is very, you should think like an evaluator. Whenever you write an answer, you should understand that, you know, on which particular point evaluator is going to be impressed. You should know, right? Now, related to this is that, you know, you should not trouble or irritate or bother the examiner. It is very important. You know, see, because evaluator is the one who is going to give you marks, right? So you have to make him happy, him or her happy. Your job is to please him. Your job is not to irritate him, not to trouble him, not to bother him. Your job is to give him what he wants easily. Your job is to see, evaluation is extremely boring and irritating thing to do. I have evaluated so many answer sheets of UPSC mock tests as well as the university papers. Believe me, evaluation is the most boring job for any teacher. See, if you ask me to teach, I will be very happy to teach. But if you ask me to evaluate, it is a very boring job. It is, mind you, believe me, it's very boring job. Now, pehle se hi wo job boring hai. Ab aap wo answer, aap kharab answer likhke aur zyada us kaam ko boring agar karoge, to wo aapko kam marks dega. Okay, so ultimately the nature of evaluation is that, you know, it is very boring. So, and it is very time taking. You know, it takes time to evaluate 20 questions. It's very time taking task. So that is why do not bother or trouble or irritate an examiner. Usko jo chahiye, wo jo usko chahiye, wo jo aap se expect kar raha hai, give him easily. Okay, right? And how to give what examiner want easily, there are various ways to do that. How you can use underlining, you can write, you can underline the keywords, you can break the answer into headings and subheadings, you can draw diagrams, flowcharts, graphs. For example, if the question is on international relations, you can use maps as well, right? And through maps, suppose the question is on Tapi pipeline, or suppose the exam, the question is on, say, Sir Creek dispute between India and Pakistan, or if the dispute is on, say, for example, if the dispute between India and Pakistan on Siachen Glacier. Okay, and why demilitarization of Siachen Glacier and why it is not happening? Because the armies are in -90 degrees, and the armed forces, they are stationed in Siachen Glacier in minus, and the soldiers from both sides, they are getting killed, for no added advantage, you know. So if both the countries, they decide to demilitarize, it is going to benefit both the countries. But why it is not happening? Why it is not happening? Because there are various, there are trust issues, है ना, अगर हमने सियाचिन ग्लेशियर से अगर हमने अपनी आर्मी निकाल ली तो पाकिस्तान सियाचिन ग्लेशियर को कैप्चर कर लेगा. सो देयर आर सर्टेन अप्रिहेंशंस. सो सपोज देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन ऑन डीमिलिटराइजेशन, डीमिलिटराइजेशन ऑफ सियाचिन ग्लेशियर एंड व्हाट आर द प्रॉब्लम्स. सो यू हैव टू ड्रॉ मैप. इफ यू एक्सप्लेन, सो यू हैव टू ड्रॉ मैप, यू हैव टू जस्ट ड्रॉ द मैप ऑफ कश्मीर टू शो वेयर इज सियाचिन ग्लेशियर. And through point, you can say that, okay, this is Indian Army. This is Indian Army. And यहाँ पे Pakistan Army, जो भी, whatever it may be, जो ऊपर है, no, our army is here. Our army is strategically located. हम लोग ऊपर है, ठीक है, right? So, and Pakistan is नीचे, है ना, ऊपर से नीचे strategic location है, ठीक है? तो अगर CH, मतलब point ये है कि अगर आपको कोई question है, जो map से related, अगर आपको question लगता है कि map के through में इसको अच्छे से present कर सकता हूँ, तो use map. हाँ, अगर कोई फ्लो चार्ट से रिलेटेड अगर क्वेश्चन आप लिख सकते हो, वेल एंड गुड, ठीक है. यू कैन ड्रॉ फ्लो चार्ट ऐसे ऐसे करके, यू कैन राइट वेरियस एलिमेंट्स यहाँ पे ऐसे, है ना. सो एग्जामिनर को पूरा पैराग्राफ पढ़ना नहीं पड़ेगा, यू नो, ही कैन, और यू कैन राइट दिस एज वेल, है ना. सब लोग, कुछ लोग ऐसे लिखते हैं, है ना, ऐसे पॉइंट्स करके, है ना. देर आर सो मेनी वेज ऑफ राइटिंग बाई यूजिंग ऑफ यूजिंग डायग्राम्स एंड फ्लो चार्ट, ठीक है. सो By using this tactics, you can make your answer, you can give what examiner exactly wants you to do. For example, if there are four steps involved in a particular answer, step one, step two, step three, step four. Okay, so rather than writing answer in a subjective matter, you can write such boxes. Step one, you know, step one, write one, two lines here or here itself, right? Step one, point 1, 2, 3, then step 2, point 1, 2, 3, 4, step 4. So only through diagram you can write answer, you don't need to write paragraph, right? So there are so many questions in which you can write diagram, you can explain diagrammatically. For example, if there is a question on base superstructure model, of Marx, Karl Marx, I'm repeatedly giving you example of Marx because he's my favorite thinker, right? So you can write about this is base, which is economic structure, and this is superstructure. Now superstructure has law, it has civil society, okay, it has religion, so on and so forth, right? So this is how you can, and then you can also write here small, you can write here. I'm not drawing good diagram deliberately because I don't have time. You can write civil society here, okay, then you can write civil society acts as a shock absorber, okay. So you can, so the point I'm trying to tell you is that you can explain base superstructure model of Karl Marx through diagram also. Okay, so if the examiner is looking at your diagram, then he will be impressed and he'll get to know that yes, you know the answer of this question, and he will not bother. He will not have to read entire answer of yours because you have already given him what he wants through diagrams. Okay, so this is regarding rule number 7, right? Give what examiner wants easily by using underlining keywords, headings, subheadings, diagrams, so on and so forth. Now, rule number 8 is also regarding presentation, is, you know, writing answers in a simple and easy to understand language. Language is very, very important. See, don't think that if your English is weak, then you will not be able to clear mains. No, understand that UPSC mains is not an examination to test your communication skills. How well you write answers, how well you use your vocabulary. No, this is not a vocabulary test. You know, this is the test of your understanding of a particular subject, right? And you're not supposed to use jargons and difficult words. You know, you have to write your answers as if, even if the child of 7 to 8 years reads your answer, he should be able to understand what you have written along with the conceptual clarity, right? For example, as a bureaucrat, not everybody will have your level of knowledge and understanding. So you have to tell the, you as a bureaucrat, you will have to deal with common people. So as a bureaucrat, you should be able to speak in the language of masses, in the language of common people. Then only you will be able to convey what exactly you want to convey. If you use your knowledge of economics or political science, for example, if you use the concepts like alienation, class struggle, historical materialism in front of common person, they are not going to understand you, right? So as a civil servant, you should be able to express yourself by using simple and easy to understand language, because you're going to deal with commoners. You're not going to deal with experts, right? So that is why, and this quality is, see, UPSC tests your personality not only in your personality test. UPSC tests your personality in each and every level, at each and every level of examination. In prelims, your ability to absorb pressure is tested. You know, in mains, your ability to express yourself effectively, time management, etc. All these skills are tested. And your presentation and your personality test, the other qualities along with the ability to handle pressures, time management, so all of. So don't think ki jo aapki jo qualities hai, aapki jo personality ka jo test hai, wo sirf interview mein hoga. Nahi. At every level of UPSC, your personality is being tested, right? So understand the UPSC, understand the demand of the exam and try to prepare accordingly, right? So this is regarding rule number 8, right? And why answer, I think answer should be written in a simple, lucid and easy to understand language. Why? Because answer writing for UPSC is different than academic writing or writing newspaper articles or writing novels. Okay, you know, so you have to write answers not as if you are an academician. No, you know, the way academician will write on a particular issue will be different as compared to UPSC civil services aspirant, right? So understand this, that the demand of UPSC is not academic answer writing or not writing answers like writing poetic answers. This you can do this in essay. But even in optional subject, you have to write simple and easy to understand language through academic angle. I am not saying that in optional subject, you're supposed to write answers through like a commoners. No, you have to use concepts and academic lenses of UPSC, but you should write answers in an easy language, right? So this is rule number 8. Now next is rule number 9. Now rule number 9 is again related to psychology of evaluator or examiner. You know, you have to make your answers interesting to read. You know, your answers should be intellectually satisfying for the examiner. You know, your answer, see, most of the evaluators, they are old, okay, and they seek some kind of intellectual gratification out of this boring, utterly boring job of evaluation, right? So you have to give some kind of intellectual satisfaction to that evaluator because they are old. Now, the old people, they do not want money. They do not crave for money. What they crave is intellectual gratification. So give them. And how to do that? How to do this? How to make your answer interesting and how to make your answer intellectually satisfying for the examiner? You can do this by linking the question to contemporary events. You can write about the contemporary relevance of the topic or question. You can give suitable examples. You can quote suitable case studies, so on and so forth. This is how you can make your answer interesting to read, right? For example, if the question is on, say, Plato's theory of philosopher king, right? Even if Plato gave this theory 500 years back, you should be able to write the contemporary relevance of the Plato's theory of philosopher king. How the Plato's theory of philosopher king has some relevance even in the 21st century, right? For example, in Indian Parliament, the 43% of members of current Lok Sabha, they have criminal charges pending against them. Then most of the members of Parliament, they are illiterate, or they do not have education beyond 10th or 12th standard. And what Plato said that the philosophers should rule, the educated people should rule. Where in India, the illiterate people, they are sitting in the parliament and they are making rules, right? So in that sense, in one way, you can write about the contemporary relevance of Plato's theory, which he gave in 4th century BC, right? So you have to make your answer interesting to link, interesting to read by linking your topics through contemporary relevance, through contemporary issues. You can also give suitable examples, case studies, so on and so forth, right? So this is how you can make your answer interesting to read and intellectually satisfying for the examiner. Then the next rule is rule number 10. That is very, very simple. If your English is weak, if your communication skill is weak, it's okay. But you cannot commit grammatical and factual errors and mistakes. Avoid grammatical and factual errors. For example, if Keshavananda Bharati case, if the Supreme Court has given basic structure doctrine in Keshavananda Bharati case, then you cannot write that Supreme Court has given basic structure doctrine in, say, Minerva Mills case. Or you cannot write, instead of 1973, you cannot write 1976. Because this is factually incorrect. Keshavananda Bharati judgment came in 1973. And not in 1976. So you cannot make facts. If India's literacy rate, according to 2011 census, is 74, approximately 74%, then you should write 74%. You cannot write 64% or 84%. This is factually incorrect. And examiner will cut your marks because he will get to know that you're bluffing. You're bluffing, you know, don't do that. So, and do not make silly grammatical mistakes, particularly when it comes to optional students. They make grammatical mistakes in writing name of the authors and their books. For example, there is one author whose name is Polanza. So Polanza ka spelling is Polanzas. Now, instead of these students, they write Polanza. Or they will write P-O-L-A-T-Z, Polan. So this is wrong. Do not make grammatical mistakes in writing names of the authors. Okay? Right? So this is the rule number 11. Then rule number 11 is very, very important. Again, do not cross word limit. Okay? There is a reason why UPSC gives word limit at the end of every question. And, you know, mind you, there are penalties as well. If you have crossed word limit, then the examiner, they will cut your marks. There will be a penalty for crossing word limit. Yes, it is there. It is absolutely there. Read, and there are marks for handwriting as well. Some marks, if your handwriting is extremely bad, then examiner can cut your marks as well. Okay, so read the notification of UPSC or prelims very carefully. You will get to know these points. Okay, so do not cross word limit. Why? Again, why I told you, because as a civil service aspirant, as a future civil servant, you should know how to express yourself by using few words. I told you about the Thomas Jefferson's quote, the biggest talent any person can have is to use one word instead of two words to explain the same thing, right? So you should be able to express yourself effectively. And second is, you know, the be it GS, be it PSIR, the paper is vast. You know, even if you have to attempt 5 questions in PSIR, still you don't have enough time to complete the paper. So if you cross the word limit, then you will not be able to complete the paper. And if you don't complete the paper, then your chances of clearing the mains will reduce. Okay, you have to attempt all the questions as far as possible, right? So this is rule number 11. Do not cross word limit. Okay. Now, these are the 11 golden rules which I've explained. Now, there are some general questions regarding PSIR. Okay. Now, first question candidates often ask is whether they should write answer point-wise or in paras. So answer is simple. For general studies, you can write point-wise answer. You should write point-wise answer because you don't have time, and examiner always search for points in general studies. But for optional, you should write your answers in paras. Okay. But if you do not have time, if you do not have sufficient time at the end of the examination, then you can write answer in point wise. Suppose there is the last question, fifth question. Sorry, fifth of your attending fifth question, you have There are three sub-questions, A, B, C. A is for 20 marks, B is for 15 marks, and C is for 15 marks. Now you have done this. Now for writing 15 marks question, you only have 4 minutes in your hand. After 4 minutes, examination will be over. So you in this situation, you can write point-wise answer because you don't have, you have only 4 minutes. If you write answer in paragraph, you will be able to only write intro and some points about body. So if you write point-wise in this answer where you have less time available to finish the paper, then you can write point-wise. Otherwise, you should use paragraphs in optional subject. For general studies, you can write answers point-wise. Okay? Then the second question, how much to quote? So now, you know, what happens is that I've seen is optional subject candidates, they overquote the views of authors. According to Plato, according to Aristotle, according to C. Raja Mohan, instead of writing their own views, candidates only write views of authors. Don't do that. Okay? Yes, you are supposed to quote one or two authors, their views. But along with that, you are also supposed to write what you know or what you understand about that particular quote or what are your own views, because examiner wants to know your views along with the views of academicians. Yes, you're supposed to write views of academicians and thinkers and authors in your optional subject. But along with that, don't overdo. What candidate do you know? For example, if there is a question on, say, participatory theory of democracy, they will write according to XYZ. Next sentence, according to ABC. Next sentence, according to DEF. And the whole answer, they only quote the thinkers. No, don't do that. Yes, you should quote the thinkers extensively, but don't overdo it. Along with that, you should be able to explain the meaning of that particular sentence, and you should be able to write what the authors are saying in your own language as well. Okay? Then diagram, chart, flowchart, maps in every answer. Should we draw diagram, chart, flowchart, maps in every answer? A big no. No, it depends whether you should use diagram, chart, flowchart, maps or not. It depends on the question, in the nature of question. Okay? And where you should use diagram, where you should use map, where we should use a flow chart and chart, it requires practice over a period of time. Through practice, you will know where to use what. Okay? Then how much handwriting matters? Yes, handwriting matters a lot as far as psychology of examiner is concerned, but it doesn't mean that your handwriting should be excellent. Your handwriting should be legible. My handwriting is not excellent, but my handwriting should be legible. Examiner should be able to read your answer. Itna aapki handwriting sahi honi chahiye. Lekin agar aapki handwriting bahut beautiful hai, toh it will give you bonus. You will get on an average in 250 marks of optional paper, you will get 5 marks bonus if your answer handwriting is good. But even if your handwriting is good, but if your content is average, then you don't have any advantage. Your handwriting will give you bonus only if your content is good. Similarly, if your handwriting is average, but your content is excellent, doesn't matter. But your handwriting should be legible. It should not be clumsy. Okay? Then color of pen, candidates, they ask which color of pen, blue pen, black pen, kuch bhi use karo, koi farak nahi padta hai. What matters is content. What matters is presentation. Ye do cheeze important hai. मल्टीपल पेन यूज करना है नहीं करना है वो आपका है, बट अभी मार्केट में एक पेन आया है, एक पेन होता है जिसमें दोनों साइड से चलता है, ये साइड ब्लू, ये साइड ब्लैक, तो दोनों साइड वाला पेन आप इस्तेमाल कर सकते हो. जब हेडलाइन देना है तो एक पर्टिकुलर, अंडरलाइनिंग करना है तो एक ये यूज करो, अगर लिखना है तो दूसरा वाला एंड यूज करो. सो यू कैन यूज पेन हैविंग टू एंड्स. Apart from that, even if you use one color pen, doesn't matter. You know what I told you, already told you that content is important as compared to the content and presentation is important as compared to your multiple pens, so on and so forth. Then another important point is attempt all questions. It's very, very important. You know, out of 5 questions, if you suppose you feel that I will attempt only 4 questions, but I will write very good answers of these 4 questions. Okay, this logic doesn't work. Okay, if you apply law of average, you know, qualities is necessary. Okay, in UPSC, but it is not sufficient. Along with quality, writing quality answers, you also have to cover all the questions. You have to attempt all the questions. Okay, agar aap kitna bhi achha answer likh lo,
दस में से आपको छह या सात से ज्यादा मार्क्स नहीं मिलेंगे, ऑप्शनल सब्जेक्ट की बात कर रहा हूँ, और ऑप्शनल सब्जेक्ट में बीस में से आपको तेरह या चौदह से ज्यादा मार्क्स नहीं मिलेंगे, चाहे कितना भी आंसर अच्छा लिख लो। चाहे यूपीएससी ने जो खुद का आंसर दिया है ना, वो एग्जैक्टली वैसा आंसर भी कोट करोगे तो आपको इससे ज्यादा मार्क्स नहीं मिलेगा, ठीक है, राइट? सो दैट इज वाई यू हैव टू, यू हैव क्वालिटी इज नेसेसरी बट इट इज नॉट सफिशियंट, यू हैव टू अटेम्प्ट ऑल द क्वेश्चंस, ठीक है? सो ऑन अ कंक्लूजन आई विल टेल यू वन थिंग, यू नो, आंसर राइटिंग कैन नॉट बी मास्टर्ड इन वन डे और वन मंथ. It cannot be developed in one day. You know, it's answer writing is a skill, and it is a continuous process. It should be, and it is continuous and incremental process. Okay, so don't expect immediate results. You know, don't expect ki main I will write one test and I'll immediately get good marks in that test because I have covered all the syllabus and I have knowledge, I have content, and then suddenly you will expect good results. No. And don't expect good immediate results even after listening to my lectures. Even if I have told you what are do's and don'ts, then also you will commit mistakes. Then also, because it is answer writing, if answer writing would have been that easy, then every candidate would have listened one lecture of the toppers and they would have scored good marks, right? So don't expect immediate results when it comes to mastering answer writing. You know, you have to be really patient. You should not be lazy, you know, and you should keep practicing, and slowly and gradually you will realize the difference. You'll realize that you if you compare your answer which you have written, if you compare your first answer with your last answer between the period of 4 to 5 months, you yourself will be surprised to read your own answer. You'll be surprised at how well you have written your answer, right? So have patience and keep practicing and keep learning, right? So this is about the answer writing, and now I think I will take your questions regarding PSIR optional subject course. What do you expect from this course and other similar things? Okay, I have finished my presentation. I hope it will help you. Now, I guess you guys can ask questions. Well, there are 14. Okay. Now, I have already told you about the importance of optional subject and importance of optional writing in mains. Okay. Now, regarding what will be delivered in the classroom. If you join the optional subject coaching here at Diademy IAS, then first thing which I personally assure you is that complete coverage of the syllabus. You know, we will cover each and every point of the syllabus. Now, why I am telling you, you know, what is new in this? Every coaching institute claims that we will cover the syllabus, but you know, claiming and fulfilling, these are two different things. Now, what I have seen is that in political science optional is very vast. Okay. And what happens is that I have seen that the other coaching institutes, what they do, they give disproportionate amount of time to cover first paper. So by the time the second paper comes, the teacher, they do not have enough time. So paper one, most of the teachers, they cover in a very systematic manner. But when it comes to Indian thinkers, when it comes to international relations, when it comes to comparative politics, which is a dynamic part of political science optional subject, most of the coaching institutes, they complete the syllabus in hurry. Why? Because they spend disproportionate amount of time on paper one. That will not be done here. We will give you equal importance to each and every paper one as well as paper two. We will, and you know, what I have seen is that candidates, they face problem in paper two of political science optional subject. Why? Because paper two, first of all, paper two, most of the teachers, they do not cover the syllabus of paper two extensively. Why? Because they run out of time. साढ़े पांच महीने में उनको सिलेबस खत्म करना होता है, उसमें से साढ़े तीन महीने वो पेपर वन में ही चलाते हैं, ठीक है? तो इनको उनके पास पेपर टू का सिलेबस करने के पास बहुत कम समय बचता है, और इसके लिए स्टूडेंट का नुकसान होता है. दैट थिंग विल नॉट बी डन हियर एट आर इंस्टीट्यूट, राइट? वी विल बी कवरिंग आई विल बी कवरिंग ईच एंड एवरी पॉइंट ऑफ सिलेबस बाई गिविंग इक्वल इंपॉर्टेंस.
And second is that, you know, the paper two is little difficult to understand. So my more focus will be focusing on those topics of paper two, which are difficult to understand. For example, comparative politics or approaches to comparative politics or say theories of international relations. These are a little difficult to understand. The next part of paper two is dynamic, like Indian foreign policy and recent challenges and opportunities in Indian foreign policy. These are all dynamic papers, right? So there I will try to reduce your burden to, I'll try to give you as many ready to read handwritten notes as possible, right? Okay, so we will cover the entire syllabus. बड़े इत्मीनान से बड़े आराम से भले चार नहीं पांच नहीं साढ़े पांच नहीं अगर छह महीने लगेंगे तो भी चलेगा बट वी विल कवर द सिलेबस इन अ वेरी सिस्टमैटिक मैनर बाय गिविंग इक्वल बाय डूइंग इक्वल जस्टिस टू ईच एंड एवरी टॉपिक ऑफ द सिलेबस आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू डिस्क्रिमिनेट बिटवीन पेपर वन एंड पेपर टू बिकॉज बोथ पेपर कैरीज इक्वल वेटेज 250 मार्क्स ईच राइट सो आई एम गोइंग टू गिव इक्वल इंपॉर्टेंस विच इज नॉट डन इन अदर इंस्टीट्यूट सेकेंड आई विल बी गिविंग यू handwritten notes on every topic as far as possible right so wherein the answer writing practice will also be done in the classroom itself wherein I will give you ready made answers for a particular question for example political science is a master science this is a quote of Aristotle so I'll make you write the answer I will ask you to write answer and then I'll give you model answer as well ठीक है सो एक्सटेंसिव handwritten notes will be given to you and wherever required wherever necessary I will also give you printed notes as well ठीक है so this is and then along with this there will be weekly class tests as well so whoever joins this course the answer writing practice is also inbuilt in this entire program of optional sub PSIR optional subject So that by the time you join the test series, you know how to write answers. You should not start from the scratch. So for every week, there will be at least one test wherein I'll give you two or three questions to write, and then there will be a discussion on those questions. Okay. So we are going to deal with political science in a very systematic and a very professional manner. Right. So these are the things I'm going to provide you. Then along with that, I'll also give you some readings as well, some extra readings for value addition. But I think that is necessary only for those who have lack of clarity on particular topic. But this will not happen if you join the optional subject coaching here. Right. So the attempt will be made to give you one-stop solution for political science optional subject. Okay, the attempt will be made to ensure that once you join the coaching, once you join the class, once you revise the notes and the handwritten notes of the class, you will not be required to read anything else, right? So that will be the attempt, and that will be done. Okay. है ना सारी चीजें आपको एक ही जगह पे बहुत सिस्टमैटिक तरीके से आपको दी जाएगी ठीक है और जो भी स्टैंडर्ड और जो नोट्स बनते हैं जो भी मेरे नोट्स है दीज नोट्स आर फ्रॉम अ वेरी स्टैंडर्ड सोर्सेस लाइक एंड्रू हेवुड्स ओपी गौबा यू नो फादिया एंड फादिया जेसी जोहरी देन द अदर बुक्स राइट सो देयर आर वेरियस बुक्स So, जो जो इम्पोर्टेंट चीजें मुझे लगी है वहां से मैंने आई एम गोइंग टू गिव यू नोट्स और जो जो चीजें मुझे यूजलेस लगती है जो कि काम के नहीं है दैट आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू एज वेल कि ये बुक है इसमें से आप ये पैराग्राफ अगर पढ़ोगे तो फॉर बेटर अंडरस्टैंडिंग यू कैन रीड दैट ठीक है यू कैन फॉलो दैट बट अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट इफ यू फॉलो द क्लास नोट्स दैट्स इनफ ठीक है सो ये कोशिश रहेगी कि अगर आपने ढाई सॉरी साढ़े पांच छह छह साढ़े पांच या पांच साढ़े पांच महीने का अगर ये कोर्स किया तो आपके पास एक रेडीमेड मटेरियल है आपके पास हैंड रिटन नोट्स है ठीक है तो वो आप पढ़ के आंसर राइटिंग प्रैक्टिस करके दैट शुड बी इनफ यू शुड नॉट बी देर विल नॉट बी एनी रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ रीडिंग एनी अदर मटेरियल और एनी अदर सोर्सेस ठीक है दैट इज गिवन इन दिस कोर्स ठीक है सो दिस इज वॉट वी विल बी डिलीवरिंग नाउ यू कैन आस्क वॉट एवर योर क्वेश्चन आर ठीक है And once again, I'm really sorry for delaying this session for half an hour. There was little confusion. I'm extremely sorry for that. You know, I hope you guys will forgive this. Anyway, so any questions? You guys have any questions? You can type your questions. You can turn on your audio or you can ask. Better is to turn on your audio and ask. Feel free to ask anything. Any question you can ask. Yes. Charges of the course. Oh, this is something which you will get to know through the website, right? Anything else? See, let's not discuss the charges and thing. Ask questions regarding political science optional subject, which I can answer, right? I'm here to guide you about political science and international relations as an optional subject and answer writing. These are the two things which I'm supposed to deal with, not the business and economic aspect of that. So please visit the website or contact the concerned person. You will get to know. Any other question?
Hello, sir.
Yes. Where are you?
Hello, sir.
Yes. Yes, yes.
Sir, my question is, sir, in part first of...
Can you please introduce yourself before you ask your question?
Yes, sir.
And state from where you speaking. That is also required.
Okay, yeah. Okay, yes, sir. Just a minute, sir. I'm turning on my video, sir.
Okay. Yes, yes, Kumar, yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm from Bihar, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. My question is, sir... on paper first, sir, there are some historical events regarding making of the Indian constitutions as well as the things which is mentioned in the syllabus. Right now, I'm not recalling it word by word. So my
yes.
question is, sir, how to correlate these all things from political science point of view, sir? Because we should have to read this in GS paper 1 and some part in GS paper 2 also, sir.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Yes, I want to know, sir, how to correlate with the political science point of view.
First of all, you need to understand that the answer of general studies, your perspective from general studies point of view will be totally different. And your answer from political science optional perspective will be different. You cannot write the same answer for political science optional and you cannot write the same answer for GS as well. So in GS, you can write an answer from a generalist perspective, wherein you don't have to quote authors, you don't have to give historical evidences, historical background, so on and so forth. In general, you can write a general answer. But for optional subject, you have to write very, very specific answer. For example, you spoke about making of Indian constitution, right? So when it comes to optional subject, when you deal with this topic of making of Indian constitution, you should focus on constitutional assembly debates, right? The constituent assembly debates, whatever debates that happened in the constituent assembly, that you should focus on. For example, constituent assembly debates on secularism, for example, constituent assembly debates on Article 44, views of Ambedkar, views of other members of drafting committee, views of Jawaharlal Nehru, so on and so forth, right? So when you deal with making of Indian constitution in political science optional, you should look at the philosophical debates which were conducted during the constituent assembly sessions. So you should focus on the philosophical and ideological debates when it comes to optional subject. But when it comes to prelims or mains for general studies, making of Indian constitution will include how the constituent assembly was elected. Was it directly elected or indirectly elected? On the basis of which plan the constituent assembly was made, how many members constituent assembly had, what was the representation of princely states in constituent assembly, you know, and what were the criticisms of constituent assembly. It was dominated by Congress, it was dominated by Hindus. So your question, your approach from general studies point of view will be more of just an introductory thing, that what was constituent assembly, how constituent assembly was of India was elected, on which basis it was elected. For example, Constituent Assembly was elected on the basis of Cabinet Mission Plan of 1946. And the members of Constituent Assembly, they were elected indirectly by elected members of the provincial state legislative assemblies. Okay, so what was the scheme of the election? Then how many seats were allotted to princely states? How many seats were allotted to provinces? For example, in Constituent Assembly of 1946, it had 389 members. 389 members, right? Out of these 389 members, I think 93 members, 93 seats were allotted to princely states, and 296 seats were allotted to the provinces. But after partition, the strength of the Constituent Assembly was reduced from 389 to 299, wherein 229 seats were allotted to 11 Indian provinces, and 70 seats were allotted to Indian princely states. Right, so this is the composition of India's Constituent Assembly before partition and after partition. So this is what is required for gender studies, right? In gender studies, Constituent Assembly debates, philosophical and ideological underpinnings of constitution, this is not required. But for optional subject, it is very, very important. For optional subject, you are supposed to understand the views of Granville Austin, who was an expert of Indian constitution. He wrote a book, Indian Constitution and Cornerstone of a Nation, right? So you have to approach the same topic from a philosophical, ideological and historical perspective in optional. But for GS, you have to look at only the basic details. What was Constituent Assembly, how it was elected, how many members it had, and its criticism. That's it. You don't have to go much into detail. But in optional subject, you have to go into detail. You have to look into philosophical and ideological debates, so on and so forth, right? Yes? Yes, Kumar, I hope this answers your query.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Obviously, sir.
Yeah. Then the second. Yes, Kumar, you have another question?
Yes, sir, obviously, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in paper second, sir, the syllabus mentioned like... India and Global South relation with the South Africa and Latin America. Sir, but while observing the previous question, I saw only, I don't saw any question relating to Latin America, but there's a question, sir, how many countries should we focus from India's perspective for international relations and any type of relations like trade relations, financial relations, numbers of the relations the India possessing. Sir, my question is like, how many countries we should follow or how many countries we should focus
on? First of all, there was a question on India-Latin America relations in PSIR. There have been questions on India-Latin America relations, both in gender studies and optional subject as well. Okay. But the question was general. Okay, what are the opportunities and challenges in India-Latin America relations? But yes, you're right, that question will be only one or two. So you should have a basic content on India-Latin America relations. That is important. You should not go into detail. Second, you ask which countries to focus. For example, Latin America has 39 to 40 countries. So you can't deal with India, Bolivia, India, Portugal, India, Brazil, India. You can't deal with India's relation with each and every country in the Latin America. What you have to do is that you have to focus on India and Latin America as continent. What are the challenges and opportunities in general? India or Latin America ke beech mein kya kya opportunity? For example, agriculture. In agriculture, there are a lot of opportunities. Latin America has a lot of land. Then in biofuels, right? In they have sugarcane, then their biofuels, so on and so forth. There we can cooperate. Pulses, import of pulses, they can help. Oil and gas, they have enough resources of oil and gas, energy security, food security, right? So there are various elements of cooperation between India and Latin America as a continent. Okay? So you have to prepare this. But when it comes to in Latin America, which countries you should focus? I think you should focus on big countries like Brazil, like Argentina. Why? Because Indian foreign policy is more focused on, because these are regional leaders. Nobody is going to ask you a question on India's relations with Panama. No, nobody. UPSC is not going to ask question. So, अगर आपको पता करना है कि कौन से कंट्रीज के ऊपर ज्यादा ध्यान दे, आपको करंट अफेयर्स पढ़ना पड़ेगा. करंट अफेयर्स में पिछले डेढ़ साल में प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी कहाँ कहाँ विजिट किए हैं, G20 में या ब्रिक्स में या इप्सा में या इंटरनेशनल ग्रुपिंग्स में, इस कॉन्टिनेंट से कौन से कंट्रीज ज्यादा एक्टिव है, कौन से कंट्रीज हमारे यूनाइटेड नेशन सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल के परमानेंट मेंबरशिप के लिए हमको सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं, कौन सी कंट्रीज एनर्जी सिक्योरिटी के लिए इंडिया के लिए बहुत काम में आ सकती है, फूड सिक्योरिटी के लिए काम में आ सकती है, ऐसे कंट्रीज के ऊपर आपको फोकस करना है. एंड दैट यू विल बी एबल टू नो ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ करंट अफेयर्स. दैट्स इट. ठीक है. बट एंड द आउटसाइड यू कैन फोकस ऑन ब्राजील एंड अर्जेंटीना. वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. Because Brazil is part of G4, which supports India, which are a part of countries which claim permanent membership in United Nations Security Council, whereas Argentina is a part of Coffee Club, which opposes the membership of India in United Nations Security Council, right? So you should focus on these two countries. Apart from that, if there is any visit by Indian President and Indian Prime Minister in that particular year, then you can obviously, but you don't have to go into that detail, right? Fine. Then next question, I think someone has written some question. Should I study political science with combined perspective in prelims, mains, optional? I mean, there is no question. There is no optional subject is not asked in prelims level, right? Optional is only at the mains level. So there is no question of combined strategy of optional. Optional subject comes into picture only during the mains and interview. ठीक है. हाँ, बट इफ यू आस्क मी वेदर योर स्ट्रैटेजी ऑफ जनरल स्टडीज पेपर टू एंड स्ट्रैटेजी ऑफ इंडियन गवर्नमेंट पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ पार्ट ऑफ पेपर वन शुड बी सिमिलर, यस, इट शुड बी कंबाइंड. यू शुड, देर इज नो नीड टू प्रिपेयर सेपरेटली फॉर जनरल स्टडीज पेपर टू इफ यू स्टडी फॉर इंडियन गवर्नमेंट पॉलिटिक्स इन डिटेल. बट इन जनरल स्टडीज यू शुड फोकस मोर ऑन फैक्ट्स फॉर प्रीलिम्स, बट इन मेन्स यू शुड फोकस मोर ऑन एनालिसिस. That is what I can tell you, right? Yes, Badal, is it clear? Yes. Any other question? I hope most of the queries I've been able to deal with. Now, regarding the fees, the date of admission for 2022 batch, all these queries you can get the information from the management, right? Fine. So thank you guys. I think it's sufficient today. It's that is all for today. Thanks a lot. And irrespective of whether you join this my coaching or not, or the Diademy IAS or not, all the best for your future endeavors, right? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Kumar, and all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Do well.
Obviously, sir.
All right, I am also leaving the meeting, right? Yeah.